5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Good evening and welcome. Hello. Hello and hello to our online family. Thanks to Sir Brian. God bless you. More of that later. Let's pray. Let's pray. Lord Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit and Father God, we thank you, Lord, for this day. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. We thank you, Lord, that we have life and we have breath. Thank you for the blessing of keeping us through today. Thank you for that we have the freedom to come and meet, gather together to meet, to worship you. Holy Spirit, please take charge of this meeting. Fill each and every one of us with a renewed anointing from you. Open our hearts, our ears, and our minds to what you have to say to us. Lord, we thank you, we praise you. We need you. Lord, help me as I lead this service, Father God. And I just pray that it is all of you and none of me. Lord, I pray that everything that we hear and learn, it will be from you, and that you will take it and plant it plant your seed in the soil of our heart, Lord, and let it germinate and grow and produce a rich harvest of your righteousness. We ask these things in the name of Jesus. And God's people said, amen, 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 amen. So, welcome, welcome, welcome. Welcome again, everybody watching online. A big shout out, first and foremost, to Brian and Anne. God bless you. Brian is the reason why you online family can see us. And Anne, we are thinking of you. We are praying for you. We are standing with you. Now, normally, We give a big shout out to Sam in our online family. But amazingly, Sam is here. Sam is with us in person. Sam is with us in person. Now, forgive my excitement. Actually, I'm not going to apologize for it at all. Because this man has been in hospital he was telling me, for 4 months. The last time he was out of hospital was Christmas Day of 2023. I'm sure it feels like Christmas Day of 2019, but 2023. So this is Sam's first time out of hospital this year. He's been in hospital continually. So we'll all make a great big fuss of Sam, and rightly so. But for those of you who've never been to Koinonia before, just put your hand up if you've never been to a Koinonia service before. I know there's at least two of you. Don't be shy. Three of you. Welcome, welcome, welcome. So let me ask you, do you know what Koinonia means? It is fellowship. And so because of that, a very deliberate part of the service, in Greek. So because of that, very deliberately, we make the first part of the service, the opening part of the service, a meet and greet. And we especially welcome our newbies. Now, we've had technological issues, but the enemy will not prevail. So normally we have a handheld mic that's wireless. So I would come to you and find out your names. But if you could shout out your names, please. Tomily. Tomini. Tomini. Thank you. Tomini. Zena. Zena. Princess Warrior Zena. Yes, and Alicia. Alicia, Zena, and Tomini. So, folks, what we now do is we spend a bit of time saying hello to each other. But now we have four special guests. So when you say hello to each other, make sure that you go and pick out these people. Tomini, Princess Warrior Zena, and Alicia. Yes, and of course, Sam. So off you go, off you go. It's so good to see you all, church family. So for those of you that haven't been to Koinonia before, it is obviously Sunday evening service. We have it once a month on the third Sunday of every month. And it's a little bit different to conventional, I won't say normal church, but conventional church. It's certainly very different to our Sunday morning service. It's a magazine style type where we have short, sharp, snappy segments that it'll all unfold and you'll see. We hope you have a good time. Now, before I move on, any of the three of you, I know this is your first time to Koinonia, but is this your first time to Elim Leicester? Have you been on a Sunday morning? You have been on a Sunday morning. You haven't. So this is your first time here. Wait there. It's all good. So welcome. Well, read it later. Thanks. Read it later. You know, when you're studying, and the teacher hands out a text or and immediately students' heads go down to the paper and they stop listening to the teacher. Not that I am the teacher, but you can read that at your leisure. We have such a fun-filled, exciting, packed program for you. And we, after the meet and greet, we kick off with worship. And you might think, well, where's the band? We don't need the band. Because if you look to the screen, you will see we have we make a habit of having two worship songs to begin with. An oldie but goodie hymn, and then a more modern one. So if you take, stand on your feet, and we'll worship our Father God, and then we'll move on with the service. Brian, we're starting with the worship songs. Thank you.
Strong deliver, strong deliver me. our Lord in Manchester, a certain place in a certain area of Manchester. There are lots of people who are leaving an establishment having watched a football game, and they were not ashamed of cheering on their team. Sadly, only the majority of the people were happy, a few of them weren't. But never mind, never mind. God loves all football fans, amen? Amen, amen. So, we start with worship, and then we move into a very important section. And the next section that we do the same sections every week, but obviously we change the content. And the next section is called The Power of a Testimony. And this is really important. Why is it important? Because we go from scripture. In fact, Elim Lester and Koinonia is built upon this book, God's Holy Word. If it ain't in it, then I'm not interested. And if it is, then this is what we follow. And this is the reason. The power of a testimony. You know, some people are shy about giving their testimony, but it's not only important, it's scriptural. Why? Revelation chapter 12, verse 10 and 11 says this, "Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, 'Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ.'" Amen. The authority of his Christ. Here's why it's important. "For the accuser of our brothers, who accuses them before our God day and night," Satan is the accuser of the brethren, and he is accusing us before God 24/7. That's, well, don't get me started. So, we're not having that, are we? Is this mic working? Hitesh, thank you for coming. Big round of applause for our sound guy, Hitesh. Thank you. Bless you, bless you, bless you. So, let's try again. Testing, 1, 2. "The accuser of the brethren, we are not going to have it that he is accusing us before God day and night." We're not having it, are we? No, no. "For the accuser of our brothers, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down." Verse 11 says, "They overcame him." This is important. "They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. And they did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death." You know, if you believe in something that much, how much do we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ? Are we prepared to give our lives? I hope, should the test come, please God, let me be standing. But before that, we are going to give our testimonies. Now, here at Koinonia, we have a mixture of videos, which we've got today, but also live testimonies. Because I'm really interested in the stories of our people here at Leicester Elim, because we have some stories to tell about the goodness of God. Amen. And a testimony doesn't just have to be about how you came to know the Lord. It can be as simple as something that he's done in your, well, it's not simple, but something as recent as what he's done in your life. But this is a story of somebody, as you will see, who was probably as far from God as one can get. And this is what Jesus did for him.
"Me and my brother right here, Lord, we touch and agree right now, Lord. We just lift this request up to you. We want to know your will. We want to know your ways, God. Holy Spirit, breathe on my brother. Give him the strength to do what he has never been able to have the strength to do before, Lord. To leave behind the old desire."
Well, my name is Christian Layden. I'm a man of God and a servant of Christ. This is who I am. This is what I do. I'm so thankful to be able to have this opportunity. Story. Growing up, I didn't have my father around any much at all. And I grew up as a kid. We moved around every year or two, so I was always the new kid. I was always searching for acceptance. My mom, she struggled. She was working 2 jobs to raise me and my brother up. Some of the earliest memories I found when I was in third grade, I remember writing my mom letters, suicide note letters, and telling her I didn't want to live anymore, telling her that I didn't feel good enough. I started fighting a lot. I got really angry with a lot of people. So there was a lot of damage that was there from not having my father and things like that. And so after about 3 years of that and going through a lot of depression and sadness, and I started listening to metal music, heavy rock, hip-hop music, rap music, and all this death metal and all this music that was starting to get strongholds in my life. So I started to get these different mindsets, and they started to creep in, and they started to group into me. It's about partying, doing drugs, and getting women, and living this sort of lifestyle. And I was tired of not having friends. I was tired of not being a part of anything in this world. So I finally went to a football game, the only football game I ever been to during high school. And I seen some of my brother's old friends. So they asked me if I wanted to hang out and smoke weed with them. And just because they wanted to hang out with me, I was like, heck yeah, man, I want to hang out with you guys. Like, man, there's somebody who wants to talk with me. There's somebody who wants me to hang out with them, that wants me to be around. A reason why people wanted to hang out with me, and that was drugs and it was alcohol. It was more important to be accepted and things like that, so I would accept anything that came along with that. 3 months into me drinking and smoking, I ended up in a psych ward for telling my family about me cutting myself that I did for years. I just went through all different kinds of different stages in my life, trying to be somebody I'm not. I mean, it's just been 8 years of different institutions, drinking, AA, meth and CA, heroin, rehabs, Xanax, halfway houses, different kinds of pills, psych wards, partying, CMA, all sorts of institutions. I knew how like destructive it was for me, but I just couldn't stop. It was just all bad. I finally got locked up, and it was the best thing that could have happened to me. Being locked up, God humbled me. He put me in the belly of the fish. He got me locked up. No way to get out, no bail. Because I knew I needed God in a radical way. I needed Jesus to save me from myself. Things have gotten a lot worse than they had ever been. So I know in my heart that I needed God in a mighty way. I grew up in church, people telling me, you know, Jesus says this and the Bible says that. And I just got so annoyed inside of myself that I was like, man, I don't care about what anybody says, man. I'm tired of hearing about this Jesus dude. For the first time in my life, I desired to pick up a Bible and read it for myself. And I started reading from Matthew, and I knew that it was my only hope because I had tried everything else. I called upon him, started reading the word, and the Holy Spirit started to show me all these different things and show me how he was real. And I started doing prayer groups and Bible studies and just helping people. And it was a prime place to just be in ministry. It was amazing. Even the pastor in there, he had me preach 2 Sundays instead of him, so I got to preach in stripes, which was amazing. A lot of people that never would have gone to church went to church, and God's really showed me, without me, you are nothing. And I'm so glad he showed me that, and I always remember that. God is just doing mighty things, and he's just been so amazing in my life, and his love has transformed my life, has changed my life, and it is just leaves me no other choice but to serve him every day. And I'm just so glad to be a son of God, that we do have a real father that's out there that has the power to help us, to back up his love. His love isn't just some desire that has no action toward it. He has action toward it every day, and it's fresh today. And his love is just amazing. He is amazing. He is worthy to be praised and sought after every day. And his plans that he has for those who love him are just amazing. And it looked, and my life had an appearance of a dead situation. Everybody had just, nobody else could help me. And I believe God waits for that moment because he wants you to know that he is the one that will be there always. He's there to help when nobody else can help. And he loves you. He just wants to be with you and to converse with you and just have a conversation, and he'll meet you right where you're at. Just how his mercy and his grace and his love met me right where I was at when I had nothing to offer him but me. He didn't ask for any other thing. He just asked for us. And he'll never ask you for something you can't give. And he'll never need you to do something that you're not able to do. His plans for you are fresh every day. His love for you is fresh every day. His grace to empower you to do that which you are never able to do is fresh for you every day. And it's just amazing when you just live this and stay active and do it and abide in his word and have you and your life and your will just mingle with the word of God and Jesus. It's amazing just how beautiful your life is. God bless you, and let's just live for Jesus. Amen.
Amen. You know, if most of us met a young man like that on the street, looking like that, then I guess it's fair to say most of us would form an opinion of what that young man was like. And actually, the first part of his story was probably closer to what we would think his life was like. But never underestimate the transforming power of Jesus Christ. I said this morning, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. So for believers and non-believers alike, there is nothing, absolutely nothing that you're going through, difficulties, challenges, and even if you're held in the grip of something, it is not beyond the power of Jesus. And if he can do it for that young man, then it's probably fair to say, I don't think there's many people in here, if any at all, that have lived the kind of life that he lived. And if God can restore, save and restore that young man, he can do it for us. God's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen? Amen. Amen. So moving on, we have an addition to the program tonight. We have an addition to the program, and one of our very own, the lovely Mary, who's just hiding behind there, she wanted to come up and sing a song. And of course, we welcomed her. So let's welcome Mary as she comes up to sing a song.
It's not a secret what God can do. What is done for that young man, he can do it for you and for me. Amen. There is not a friend like our Jesus. There is not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. None as could heal all our souls' diseases. No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There is not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. There is not an hour that he is not near us. No, not one. No, not one. No night so dark, but his love can cheer us. No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There is not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. Was there a gift like the Savior given? No, not one, no, not one. Will he refuse us a bliss of heaven? No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There is not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows all about my struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There is not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about your struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There is not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. Amen.
Thank you, Mary. Bless you for standing up and honoring, ministering to us and honoring the Lord at the same time. If you could just take this down just a touch, Hitesh. Thank you so much. So, we're back on track with our regular program. And the next section we have
is this.
Ask the Bible.
Otherwise known as ATB, Ask the Bible. So what this is for our newcomers, welcome again. So we invite people, invite people. If you have a question that you've always thought, gosh, I wonder what that's about, a theological question, something, you know, a life question, then we invite you to submit that question, and then we will find a learned, honorable scholar who will, from God's word, from the Bible, find you the answer. Hence the title, Ask the Bible. And so today, we have somebody who speaks French. And actually, is it five languages? He's not talking to me. Anyway, I'm going to hand you over to Brother Etienne to come and answer this month's question, Ask the Bible. Let's welcome him. As they say in French, bienvenue. So how many languages do you speak?
Five. Thank you. Good evening. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to answer this question. So, this is my third time coming to answer the question. So it means I didn't offend the moderator last time. So that's good. Here is the question. I don't know from who, but here is the question. Does it matter if we are cremated or buried for us to be resurrected? Does it matter whether we are cremated or buried for us to be resurrected? So I'm going to explain those words first. Our key verse is Ecclesiastes 3:20. We're going to read Ecclesiastes 3:20, and then we can introduce the... All go to the same place. All come from dust. To dust all return. And that is taken from Genesis 3:19. All go to the same place. All come from dust, and to dust all return. We can even simplify the verse by saying, all go to dust. All go return to dust. It's taken from Genesis 3:19. And Genesis 3:19 says this. Adam has sinned, and God is kind of pronouncing judgment on him or punishment. And he says to Adam this. In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread till you return to the ground. For out of it you were taken. For dust you are, and to dust you shall return. And so the question is, does it matter really whether we are cremated or buried? For young children, those who don't understand the word, cremation means it's a process that uses intense temperature to turn the remains of a person who's dead into ashes. That's what cremation is. Obviously, we are used to burial, which means the process of putting somebody who's died into the ground. So does it matter for a believer to be cremated or buried? If you search the scriptures, there is no command. There is not even a verse in regard to how you need to bury the dead. For you or for me, there is not even a command on cremation or burial in the Bible. But, in the Old Testament, there are a few examples we can check and see whether there is that command. For example, in Genesis 25, verse 9. Thanks, Ali. Let's read together. His sons Isaac and Ishmael buried him in the cave of Machpelah near Mamre, in the field of Ephron, son of Zohar the Hittite. They are talking about Abraham. Abraham just died, So his two sons, Isaac and Ishmael, which is funny enough because we normally think that Isaac and Ishmael, they were not in the same area. But how did they come together to bury the dad? There were no phones, no internet. So we can assume they were not far away from each other. Abraham was buried in the cave. The next verse, please. Genesis 23. Genesis 23, 7 to 9. The Bible says, then Abraham rose and bowed down before the people of the land, the Hittites. He said to them, if you are willing to let me bury my dead. So he was burying his dead. Then listen to me and intercede with Ephron, son of Zorah, on my behalf. So he will sell me the cave of Machpelah, which belongs to him and is at the end of the field. Ask him to sell it to me for the full price as a burial site among you. So Abraham and his children, they were burying their dead. They were burying their dead. We move to Joshua 7:25. The background of the story is Achan had just sinned. He took things which were forbidden. And God said, they need to bring forward all his family. And guess what they did to them? The Bible says, Joshua said, why have you brought this trouble on us? The Lord will bring trouble on you today. Then all Israel stoned him. And after they have stoned the rest, they burned them. So after they have stoned the family of Achan, they burned them. It doesn't mean they did cremation. It just said they burned them. We don't know whether they buried the ashes after that. There is no indication in the Bible. But then we go to 1 Samuel 31. There is an interesting chapter. It says this. Saul and his son, they just died. The next day, when the Philistines came to strip the dead, they found Saul and his three sons fallen on Mount Gilboa. They cut off his head, so they cut off Saul's head, and strip off his armor, and they sent messengers throughout the land of the Philistines to proclaim the news in the temple of their idols and among their people. They put the armor of the temple of the Asherah and fastened his body to the wall of Bethshan. In other words, they cut Saul's body and they hung him somewhere in the temple. And then we come to this verse. When the people of Jabesh Gilead heard of what the Philistine has done to Saul, all their violent men journeyed through the night to Bethshan. They took down the body of Saul and his sons from the wall of Bethshan and went to Jabesh where they burned them. After they burned them, then they took their bones and buried them under Tamarisk tree at Jabesh and they fasted 7 days. Now, only in this verse, there is burial and cremation at the same time. But it's not a command. Paul is dead. The infidels or the Philistine, they are displaying his body on the wall. So some good men find the body, they burn it. Maybe it was scattered in pieces. To honor Saul, they took his body, they burned it, and then they buried his bones. So in one verse, there is a burial and cremation at the same time. But does it really matter whether you are buried or cremated? Funny that I'm answering a question about this topic and I lost my aunt yesterday. I was thinking about this. Oh my goodness. What am I going to say? Then we come to New Testament. If you go through the New Testament, there is not even an indication on burial. Apart from the story Pastor mentioned this morning, Lazarus, he was put in the tomb, and our Lord Jesus in the tomb. There is no other indication of people being buried apart from the Lazarus and our Lord Jesus Christ. And so, we come back to our question. Since all come from the dust and go back to the dust, is it really important that you are buried or cremated? Well, think about this. Noah died thousands of years ago. If he was buried by now, he's dust. I did a little bit of research. I know there are some nurses here, probably doctors watching online. It takes maybe only up to probably 50 years for the bones to decay. From 50 years onward. 50 years for the bones to disappear completely from the ground. Now, not every place, because it needs three things for the decomposition to happen. You need temperature, you need water, and you need oxygen. So if you leave a dead body outside without burying it, it will decompose faster because it's exposed to temperature, water, and oxygen. You put it in the ground, it will take longer because there is less oxygen under, less water, and less temperature. Now we come back to our question. Cremation is just faster because they put a dead body in a hot temperature and turn the body into ashes, probably in an hour or 30 minutes. And so whether you are buried, whether I'm buried, whether I'm cremated, we are going in the same place. We are going to the dust. For you, believer, one believer, whether you are buried or you are cremated, you are going to the dust. Why? Because God has said, from dust you came, and from dust you shall return. We cannot avoid that. We cannot avoid that. But the good news is this. Here is the good news. Revelation 20:13. The Bible says this. The sea gave up the dead. Just stop there. The sea gave up the dead. That means all people who died in Titanic, all people who were swallowed by fish, sharks, all of them, the sea gave up the dead. It doesn't mean only believers, because the next line says it, that we in it and death and hate gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what he has done. Each person, whether believer or unbeliever. Can you imagine people who died thousands of years ago in that flight of Noah? Can you imagine people who died in Titanic? Can you imagine people who died in Nagasaki, in Hiroshima, with that heat temperature of the bombing? Believers or unbelievers? Where is their body? Obviously, it has gone to dust. But the Bible says they will come back to life. Now, the good news for us believers, not only things will be made new, but we will have a new body. Glory to God. 2 Corinthians 5:1-4. The Bible says this. Now we know that the earthly tent is our body. It's referring to our body, the believer's body. We know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed. In other words, if we die, we have a building from God, an eternal house, eternal body, which you and me, we will have when Jesus Christ comes, when we are raised from the dead in heaven, but not built by human hands. Glory to God. So whether you are buried or you are cremated, there is hope that one day God will give you a new body. God will give you a new body. Whether they put you in a heat temperature or you go to the ground, it doesn't matter, because you will have a new body. Christ is able to give us a new body. What a wonderful news. So this body of sickness, of imperfection, one day will be renewed. We'll have a new body, and all of us will be changed. The Bible says, in a twinkling of an eye, we'll be transformed. And so as a conclusion, does it really matter if I die, whether you bury me or you cremated me? My wife, I don't care. Whether you put me in anywhere, I don't care, because sooner or later, I'm going back to the dust. And so biblically, there is no command. There is no passages on how you need to bury your dead or cremate your dead. In different cultures, for example, they always burn their dead. In Africa, you put them in the ground. In Israel, in the caves. There is no command how to bury our dead. Whether you cremate my body or you bury it, it doesn't matter, because God has power to give me a new body on the resurrection day. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Brother Etienne. You know, if that's not a reason for you to give your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ, I don't know what is. You know, death is the thing that most people on earth fear. But through Jesus, we have no fear of death. Amen? So, for our newcomers, welcome. So that's Ask the Bible. And our next section now goes like this.
A, B, C.
A, B, C. A, B, C.
So, our next section is the alphabet of abundant living. Now, Koinonia started in December of 2022. And every month we do a different letter of the alphabet. We started at A, and we've worked our way all the way through to... Anyone know what letter we're on? Anyone remember? Okay, does anybody remember what last month's letter and word was? Taji? Can I? Pardon? N! Good boy. It was N. Does anybody remember what N stood for? Pardon? No. It's the opposite of old. New! New! And the verse, what we do is we pick a letter, and as the title suggests, the alphabet of abundant living, these are principles, characteristics, or themes that help us to live a more abundant life. Okay? And so new, last month, the verse was, if any man or woman be in Christ, they are a new creation. Behold, the old has gone, the new has come. You get two news for the price of one verse there. The old has gone, the new has come. So what letters does that bring us to now? Akima! Oh what? Oh dear? No. Oh. So any guesses for O? No. Obedient! Have you been reading my notes? You're just a very obedient daughter. Yes, it is. It's obedience. Obedience. And our verse, we always pick a Bible verse. Our verse is this. It's very, very simple. Peter and the other apostles replied, we must obey God rather than men. It's that simple. And that really spoke to me. I mean, there are so many verses covering the theme of obedience. But that one really spoke to me, because we as believers here in March 2024 are being assaulted on every side, politically, socially, every which way, where it is now, we are now at the point where we're on the brink as Christians of being considered to be extremists. And we are being told subtly and not so subtly all the time that our views are outdated, they're extreme, they're all kinds of things. I'm not even going to go into that. But the bottom line is this. We must obey God rather than men. And that may have consequences, because the context of this verse, Peter and the apostles were preaching the Lord Jesus Christ, and they were taken and they were put in prison. And God miraculously delivered them from prison and said, I want you to go out and preach. And so when they came to find them in prison, to bring them forward, they couldn't find them. Somebody said, the guys you're looking for, they're preaching they're preaching over there. So they went to get them, and they said, we told you not to do this. To To which Peter and the other apostles replied, "We must obey God rather than men." So O is for obedience, which I love it. I love it when I'm planning this and I say, my wife tells me not to say this, but I'm going to say anyway. I say, "Lord, what do you want me to say?" And it was amazing if you were at church this morning, the theme that Pastor Dave spoke on, which tells me instantly that I heard God right, that this is what he wants us to hear. So alphabet of abundant living is O for obedience. Our next section goes something like this.
Left, 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 right, left. Company halt, right turn. At ease, stand easy. Right, you are a bullet lot. Pay attention. My name is Sergeant. Sergeant by name and Sergeant by rank. So from now on, you will refer to me as Sergeant Sergeant. Is that clear? When I ask you a question, you reply, "Yes, Sergeant Sergeant." Is that clear? I can't hear you, you horrible little lot. Do you understand? Yes, Sergeant Sergeant. Good. Now, for the next few minutes, your attention is fully focused on me. Eyes front, sit up straight, especially you, you horrible little man. I am watching you. Now, for the purpose of the next few minutes, I am here to give you instruction because you are all members of the army of the Lord. And it is my very sad duty to keep you all shipshape and professional. Lord, help me. Anyway, today's lesson in the army of the Lord continues from the ABC that you heard earlier. We are going to be looking at some letters because you need to read and write to be able to be effective in this army. And every single one of you needs to know what I'm about to teach you. So pay attention. Now, five letters that you need to know. And they are very simple. So listen carefully because I will be asking questions. O, B, D, N, and C. Listen carefully because this is what they mean. You there, stop picking your nose and pay attention. Are you listening? Say yes, Sergeant, Sergeant. Thank you very much. Now, first letter, O. What does that stand for? It stands for horrible. That's you lot, you horrible little men and women. Pay attention. Now, B. B is brave, because that's what you need to be in the army of the Lord. D. D is divine, because Lord knows it's only his divine help that's going to get you horrible lot through this training. N. N stands for never. I repeat, never give up in the army of the Lord. And finally, C is for Commander-in-Chief, otherwise known as Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Help me with this sorry lot, Lord. Please, I beseech thee. Stop laughing and pay attention. So there you have it. Five letters. Repeat after me. O, B, D, N, and C. Again, O, B, D, and C. Repeat. Faster, O, B, D, and C. Repeat. Faster, obediency, obediency, obediency. Do you get it? Obedience, yes. What does that mean? It means when I say jump, you say, how high, Sergeant, Sergeant? So, obedience is really important in the army of the Lord. It means you don't have to think, you don't have to say, you just have to do when I give you a command. Like I said, I say jump and you say, how high, Sergeant, Sergeant? Jump. You're getting better. You're still not quite in shape, but I'll get there yet. So remember, obediency is what you need to make it in the army of the Lord. Right, before I finish and hand over to one of the reprobates I taught earlier, he's going to talk to you as opposed to shout what obedience means. But before I go, pay attention. And the most important thing, it is very important that you join up to the army of the Lord. It's a decision you'll never regret. And best of all, you'll have me teaching you. Now, attention! Right, return! On my left, you are up a little lot. Fall in line, fall in line. Move it, move it, move it. By the left, quick march. Left, left. Stop that laughing and keep moving. Left, right, left. Left, left. Left, right, left. Left, I'm still watching.
Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Stop laughing. Okay. Oh my goodness. You know, very, very quick aside here. I'm an actor by trade. Not that you'd guess from that. And I've not had that much work recently, but I have so much fun. It's a blessing. This is my work. It's a blessing to do this, to use my skills to get the message over. So, and actually, it's the first time where the Alphabet of Abundant Living has linked in to my little message. So it's a very light-hearted film just to introduce the theme. And the theme is obedience. And my title is Obedience is Better Than Sacrifice. So let's kick off with the verse that we saw this morning, Pastor Dave introduced this morning. 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 22. It says this. Samuel said, "Has the Lord as much delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold," listen up, "behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams." So very, very quickly, before Jesus came, mankind being as sinful as they are, inevitably it's not long before they mess up. And of course, we know that God cannot and will not tolerate sin. So what did he do? He asked the people, he didn't ask them actually, he instructed them, when you've messed up, when you've sinned, I want you to make certain sacrifices. And there were a whole range of different sacrifices that God instructed his people to do. And once they'd made those sacrifices, God accepted those sacrifices. For example, one of them was a burnt offering, a burnt sacrifice, and it was done with incense, and it was a sweet-smelling savor, and it was pleasing, and it was acceptable unto God. And so that's what the people had to do when they messed up, because once they did that, God then said, okay, those sins are dealt with, they're forgiven, and we move forward. But of course, it wasn't long before the people messed up again, and so it was a constant, constant, constant cycle. And so it was very easy to get caught up in the fact that, well, if I've messed up, all I have to do is make a sacrifice. But in truth, the thing that was most important to God was relationship. I've said that before. And actually, even here in the Old Testament, what God is saying is that what's more important to me is that you obey my voice. Is that you obey my voice. Now, how does that apply to us? We can get so caught up in doing the right thing. You know, I didn't shout at my kids today. You know, I did a good turn. I helped an old lady across the road, and I was given extra change, more change than I should have gotten. I gave it back. Now, there's nothing wrong with doing all of those things, but that's not the way through to our God. That's not the way to have a great relationship with him, and it is most certainly not the way to achieve salvation. So if we're talking obedience, then let's define it. What's the definition? The dictionary definition of obedience is this: compliance with an order, request, or law, or submission to another's authority. Obedience, I'll read that again. Compliance with an order, request, or law, or submission to another's authority. So let me ask the question, why we don't obey, why we find it so difficult. And the truth is, as human beings, we just don't like to submit. We have a rebellious nature. We are born with a rebellious nature. We are born in sin, and it means, you know, we don't have to teach anybody to rebel. We don't have to teach anybody to go the wrong way. And if you're a parent in this room or watching online, and if you're a parent, you have had children, then at some point when you've told your child to do something and they haven't, or they won't, or they do it begrudgingly, or they say they'll do it and then they don't do it, all of that is our human nature. So that's why we don't. We need training. Pay attention. We do. And actually, Sergeant
illustrates the fact that in the army, in the armed forces, men and women are trained every single day to obey an order. And as Sergeant said, you don't think about it. Don't think about it, you just do it. Because in a critical moment, in a critical moment when you are in the thick of battle, if your commanding officer says, I want you to go through and do this and do that, and you're thinking, I'm not sure. When you're thinking with your own understanding, you might not do it. You might talk yourself out of it. Now you're one of a team. And your thinking and procrastination could put the team and indeed the whole mission in jeopardy. Why? Because as a soldier, you don't, nor should you, have full information of why you're doing what you're doing. Now, you might think that that's unfair, but the commanding officer knows why he has given the instruction for you to do that. And when you hesitate, it potentially compromises that. And as our beloved Pastor Dave always says, as in the natural, so in the spiritual. We don't naturally obey God. Romans 3:23, you don't need to bring it up, Ali says, for we have all sinned and fall short of God's glory. So here's the thing, what I do want you to bring up, Ali, is Romans 6, verses 16 to 18. We don't naturally obey God. Now, it's very, very simple. You know, a lot of people, when it comes to the idea of serving God or becoming a Christian, they kind of think that they're in the middle of two options, I serve God or I don't serve God. Actually, you're not. There's only two positions. You're either serving God or you're not serving God. And if you're not obeying God, you're obeying sin. And sin leads to death, which for those of you that weren't here, the alphabet of abundant living was D, followed by E, eternal life, which is what Jesus brings. So Romans chapter 6, verse 16 says this, do you not know that when you present yourselves to someone as slaves for obedience, you are slaves of the one whom you obey. I'm just going to stop there for a second. So who do you obey? Who do you obey? Because if you've not given your heart and life to the Lord Jesus Christ, then your obedience is not to him. So do you not know that when you present yourselves to someone as slaves for obedience, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin resulting in death, or of obedience resulting in righteousness. But thanks be to God that though you were slaves of sin, you became obedient from the heart to that form of teaching to which you were committed. So where does your commitment lie? What is your modus operandi? What is the thing that governs your day-to-day living? Because if it's not Jesus, if it's not his word, the Bible, then it's something else, and if it's something else, it's sin, quite simply. And having been freed from sin, you became slaves of righteousness. Obedience is really very important. It's fundamentally important. Fundamentally important. Now, if you work, you have an employer. And even if you are self-employed, and that employer has rules and regulations to which you follow. Because if you don't, you either don't get paid or you're not employed for very long. And if we are willing to work for our earthly masters, then how much more should we be willing to obey our Lord Jesus Christ? If you go back to verse 17 just for a second, Ali, there's something I just want to bring out here. It says, you became obedient from the heart. You became. It's a process. Obedience in any capacity rarely happens overnight. So we become. And it says there, you became obedient from the heart, not the head. Why is that important? Where do we think? We think with the head. And so if we became obedient from the head, at some point we would reach a point where we were asked to do something and then we'd be thinking, does this make sense? Is this right? I'm not sure. We'd be working on our own understanding. And Proverbs 3, 5 and 6 very clearly says, trust in the Lord with all your and lean not on your own understanding. So if you're not quite where you want to be in relation to obedience with Christ, don't be discouraged. It says you became obedient. It's a process from the heart to that form of teaching to which you were committed. Now, if you're talking about teaching, you would think you'd be talking about the head. Yep, it's learning, academia, but it doesn't say that. God's word says you became obedient from the heart to that form of teaching to which you were committed. So it's a matter of the heart. And finally, I close with why we should be obedient. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 19. If you are willing and obedient, you will eat the best from the land. Quite simply, it's not only what God wants us to do, but it's the way forward in terms of fulfillment, prosperity, and blessings. And when, hear me clearly, when I say prosperity, I am not talking just financially. Not at all. It's often associated with that. But obedience brings us where you will eat from the best of the land. Now, there are so many promises from God in the Bible. And most, not quite all, but most of those promises are conditional. So God says, if you do this, I will do this. And it works positively and negatively. Yeah? And so obedience is important. Because if we obey God and his word without thinking about it, now that can be hard because in our natural lives, we go about our daily business, for those of us that are adults, because we have responsibilities and we have to think soberly about things. And that's absolutely right. But we need to be prepared, just like in the armed forces, that when God says, do this, we do it. Pastor Dave spoke about it. I do thank God because when he was speaking this morning, I thought, Lord, this is exactly what I wanted to say, and therefore it's an important point for us to hear. So when God says, do this, and you'll know it. You'll know when God's on your case. You have a stirring, and then that is confirmed from several different ways, just like this word is confirmed. And the longer you take to do it, the longer it will be before, A, you get a sense of peace and rest, but B, before you then move forward. And here's the thing. Here is the thing. Your obedience, if you are disobedient, other people can suffer. What do I mean by that? The story of Jonah. God told Jonah to go to a place to preach and tell them to repent. And Jonah, as we know, ran in completely the opposite direction. So initially, those people didn't get to hear the message which they were meant to hear. They didn't get to hear the message. Now, for those of you that know the story, eventually, Jonah was put back on track and he went and preached and the people were saved. But the point being, how many times do we feel an inkling to do something, say something to somebody? So just remember, the next time you have an inkling, it's important to be obedient, because as a result of your disobedience, somebody else can suffer the consequences. It's really, really, really important. And finally, to further prove that this is an important word, I don't do this very often at all. Please behave yourself, phone. Come on now. I don't do this very often, but those of you familiar with the word for today, if you've heard it today, then you will be familiar with what I'm saying. I'd just like you to listen to this, and with this I will close. I hope this works.
The word for today is learning to listen to God, part two. In Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 19 we read, if you willingly obey me, the best will be yours. People think they can't hear from God, when in reality there are things they already know he wants them to respond to, and so far, they haven't done it. The quicker you do whatever the Lord has already told you to do, the sooner he will reveal the next step to you. His promise is, if you willingly obey me, the best will be yours. Hearing from God is something you only develop with practice, especially if you're a talker. That's why he says, "Be still and know that I am God." Psalm 46, verse 10. Our flesh is full of energy. We always want to be doing something, and it can be difficult for us to be still. Don't just talk to God when you need something. Spend time listening. He will open up many issues if you'll just be still before him. You say, "I don't think I have ever heard God talk to me." Maybe that's because you haven't learned to listen. When you ask God for something, tune your receiver. Even if he doesn't respond at that very moment, rest assured he will in due time. You may be doing some ordinary task when he decides to speak to you. And if you have honored him by learning to listen as you fellowship with him, he will speak to you at exactly the right time. Perhaps you've spent years going your own way. If so, don't despair. It's not too late to change direction. If you're willing to obey God, he will guide you on the exciting journey of learning to hear from him every day of your life. That's the word for today on UCB.
If that's not God talking to us, I don't know what is. I had no idea that that was, in fact, I prepared what I was going to say tonight before today, and that's today's message from the word for today. And if you were here at church this morning, you'll have heard what Pastor Dave said. So maybe God is trying to say something to, not God is trying to, I take that back. God is saying something to us. Obedience is really important. And just like in the armed forces, with respect, it doesn't matter how you feel about it. It doesn't matter what you think about it. Because here's the thing. It's really important to remember this. God's motives, intentions, and plans and instructions for us are always good. It's really hard to obey somebody if you question their motive. If you wonder whether what they're asking you to do is really for your good and benefit. So let me be absolutely clear. Anything and everything that Lord Father God Almighty asks us to do is for our good. It may not feel like it, and in the short term, it may not be comfortable, but it is always for our good and probably somebody else's blessing. And therefore, you don't have to think, what's in it for me, or is this any good? There's no room for thinking. And even if it's uncomfortable to do, that shouldn't stop you. It shouldn't stop you because, as we've seen, if you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. Amen? Amen. We're going to finish with our last worship song. And whilst we sing our worship song, we have an offering. If you haven't come with any money, that's absolutely fine. But we take up an offering that goes towards the church's food bank. So can I ask anyone to take? Kev, do you mind taking that round for me, please? Thank you, good man. Thank you. And Ali, if you want to, thank you so much.
We walk with the Lord in the light of his word. What a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey. For there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil he doth richly repay. Not a grief nor a loss, not a frown or a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus, but to trust and obey. What we never can prove, the delights of His love, until all on the altar we laid. For the favor He shows and the joy He bestows are for them who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Amen. Just take your seat. We are done. We are done. I hope... three new comrades. I hope you've had a good time. I hope you, well, more than having a good time, I hope you've been blessed. We are now going to finish, and there are refreshments through this side of the room here. But I have to say a huge thank you. Sir Brian, God bless you, and thank you. We live streamed the service, and Sir Brian and his good lady wife who's in hospital. So Sir Brian has, after visiting his good lady wife, Anne, and Anne, we love you, we're praying for you. He's finished visiting his wife, Anne, and he's gotten home to stream this live so that people out there can see it. Brian, we love you, we thank you. If you were here now, he'd be so bashful in saying no, 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 no. But we honor you, thank you so much. Thank you, thank you. Hitesh, the devil tried to detain you, but you got here and you're doing a fantastic job. Ali, thank you so much. Debs is next door. I hope there's some lemon drizzle cake. If you've not tried Debs' lemon drizzle cake yet, you have to do that. It's not all gone. Don't tell fibs, Pastor. And I'm going to thank you for the opportunity for doing this service. Our next Koinonia is on the 21st of April. So Koinonia, you know, at the end of every Bond movie... For those of you old enough, at the end of every Bond movie, it used to say, James Bond will return. So, Koinonia will return on the 21st of April. So let me bless you. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you His peace. He keepeth all of your bones. Not one of them is broken. Amen. Have a great time. See you, hopefully see you next Sunday, but see you in Koinonia, 21st of April, and enjoy some refreshments. God bless you.